much. Sensors are everywhere. There are hundreds of them on a car. And of course, there are sensors also on MR scanners. But not nearly as many as we think there might be in the future. Traditionally, MR imaging has involved acquiring MR data and reconstructing it into MR images. But our vision is that in the future, there might be a lot more in terms of hardware components that gather information about different physical parameters, whether it has to do with a patient, for example, through cameras or motion sensors, or maybe about the scanner itself, electromagnetic fields, or the sound that it makes. And all of this information will be fed into a more complicated reconstruction algorithm, and machine learning can open up a lot of doors in this respect. And that all this information will be taken into account toward making better enhanced MR images. So we played with some of those sensor ideas, but for us, it's an ultrasound-based sensor that ended up working well. And that will be the main topic of this presentation. So we'll start by looking at the hardware and signals involved in this kind of sensor, and then we'll look at some of the applications that we've been thinking about and pursuing, which may have to do with monitoring the breathing or the cardiac motion, depending on whether the sensor is placed on the abdomen, the chest, or even the throat. Those motion monitoring applications, they tend to be transmit-receive, meaning that some signal is sent by the sensor and received by the sensor. We'll also look at a receive-only application, where the goal is to basically spy on the clinical ultrasound scanner doing its work, and the goal is to track the motion of the probe in 3D in the hand of the user. And then at the end, we'll switch gears a little bit and look at our use of machine learning to translate contrast. Our sensors, at their heart, they have an MR-compatible single-element ultrasound transducer, which is enclosed in a 3D-printed capsule of our own design, which also includes a special membrane, which is substantial enough to contain the ultrasound gel, yet porous enough to let the gel through once some pressure is applied. If we look underneath, there is some tape for adhesion on the skin, and here you're looking at the actual sensor through the gel and through the membrane. And on top, there's a twistable lid, and applying it to the skin is quite easy, as you can see in this little video here. One simply presses it onto the skin, twist the top lid that has the effect of pushing the transducer downward toward the skin for better acoustic coupling, and as you can see, it sticks to the skin reasonably solidly. We also developed a little circuit which allows up to 4 of these sensors to be used at the time. So the general idea is that one or more of these sensors are applied to a subject or patient and accompanies him or her inside the MR scanner, and at that point in time, we now have 2 streams of simultaneous data coming in, one from MR and one from ultrasound, meaning that we have a hybrid MRI-ultrasound acquisition going on. And it's important to synchronize those 2 streams of data, for one thing, so that we could place both the MRI and the OCM, we call our sensor OCM, organ configuration motion. So both the MRI and OCM data, we want them on the same time axis so that the reconstruction can reconstruct both of them jointly. And also we want to avoid artifacts in MRI. If we were to fire the sensor during a readout window, that would create artifacts in MRI. So what we do is that we detect the RF pulse, and that's when we fire the sensor. Firing the sensor during the RF pulse is our way of just making sure we're not doing that during the readout window. So we detect the RF with the little coil, which is typically placed on the outside of the scanner. And when the RF is sending an RF pulse, then we detect a weak signal, which gets converted through the same circuit that we've seen before into a 5-volt TTL pulse. And that triggers the pulsar receiver into firing the sensor, and then the pulsar receiver switches to a receive mode and passes on the returning signal to the data acquisition box. Now, in one of the applications we'll see, we're using those OCM sensors in PET instead of MRI. So we need to synchronize the PET and the OCM acquisition, and that's actually easier because there's no artifact issue. Firing the sensor during PET acquisition does not create artifacts in PET, so the goal of the synchronization in this case is merely just to put PET and OCM data on the same time axis, and that can be done having the data acquisition box send a tag to both of these streams of data at the same time on the OCM data stream and on the PET data stream. And that's done by putting a Volters on a given pin of a given port of the PET scanner we've been using, and that gets recorded as an event with time tag and placed in the raw data file with the PET, which is called the list post file. So now let's look at a couple of applications for these sensors that we've been thinking about, and let's start with breathing. The signal from the sensors is exquisitely sensitive to breathing motion, and the beam of ultrasound energy set inside the object is on purpose and not focused, and we embrace the fact that it might bounce around or be reflected more than once on various surfaces. What we want is for the returning signal to act as a unique signature of the instantaneous configuration of organs inside the body at a given moment in time. The signal looks something like this. Each time that we fire the sensor, we get useful data for a fraction of a millisecond. That's the vertical axis here. And this can be repeated as often for as long as needed, in this case, 10 minutes. And if you look along the horizontal axis, you can see the breathing pattern, whether you're looking at the magnitude or in the phase component of these signals. Now, an alternate way of looking at these signals is to plot all of the points in the vertical directions, all of the points that were acquired after one firing of the sensor, to represent them as a cloud of dots in a velocity versus displacement space. This is heavily inspired from Doppler imaging. So when someone breathes in, at first the velocity becomes positive and the displacement increases until it's maximized at full inspiration, and then the velocity becomes negative until the displacement is minimized at full expiration. So one breath represents one little circular motion in this plane. And this circular motion can be shallower, deeper, or faster, or slower, depending on how the person being monitored is actually breathing. So now let's see how that information about breathing actually can get used. The simplest way to use it is probably just to do respiratory imaging. That's what we've done in the PET application. We've recruited 3 patients so far, and they agreed to have 1 extra PET scan performed after their clinical scan, and this extra scan was performed with sensor in place at no extra dose to them. And then 8 respiratory gates were generated, as you can see in the movie. This patient was a mix of melanoma patients. There's a coronal image and an axial image through the lungs. There were several different lesions. Some were mobile with breathing, some were not. But looking at the ones that were mobile with breathing, you can see that the respiratory gates did capture the breathing motion. In contrast, the images on the left are what the scanner would provide, which is essentially a time-averaged version of those different respiratory gates where the motion would be blurred. Now, a more complicated application that we've been pursuing is to boost temporal resolution in real-time MRI. Here, 2 different slices, sagittal and coronal, are acquired in succession with fairly low temporal resolution. But if we further include the high temporal resolution signal from the OCM, that moving band at the bottom, then we could reconstruct these images, which have higher temporal resolution, where you can see the motion is smoother. And if you were trying to track a piece of anatomy, it would be easier to do it in the data set that has a higher temporal resolution, that put both streams of data, MR and ultrasound, into account in the reconstruction process. So here we have the liver. The motion of the heart was blurred because it was not cardiac gated. Now the next application is one step again more complicated. It is what we call a scannerless real-time MRI. And the general idea here is that if someone gets scanned for a little while in the scanner with MR, with the sensor in place, we can use machine learning to try to find correlations between the 2 streams of data coming in, the ultrasound and the MR. And after a little while, the ultrasound signal becomes a surrogate for the MR images, which means that if the patient comes out of the scanner, Because the sensor is still in place and we still know the correlations, we can keep generating synthetic MR images of someone who's not in the scanner anymore. And if that patient goes somewhere else, for example, to a different scanner, like a PET scanner, this ability to generate synthetic MR images travels with him or her all the way to the other scanner, which could eventually help in terms of fusing images from different modalities, in this example, MRI and PET. In a way that would take breathing into account. As a stepping stone in that direction, we've been validating our ability to generate synthetic images outside of the scanner. And to do that, we use real-time ultrasound imaging with optical tracking of the probe as the reference and found reasonable agreement between our synthetic MR images and the ultrasound ones. More details in this paper. Now, if we move the sensor a little bit from the abdomen to the chest, the general idea here was that it is very difficult to do ECG gating at high field strength because of the magnetohydrodynamic effect. But on the other hand, our sensors are mostly impervious to field strength, so we were wondering if we could use them as a surrogate to ECG gating. So we acquired some data sets with OCM sensors in place as well as ECGs. And we wanted to see if we would be able to fake ECG signal, to convert our sensor signal, which is really an ultrasound-based signal, to convert it into something that would mimic the ECG using a long-term recurrent convolutional neural network. Here are some results on the top. It is data that was acquired outside of the CT scanner, so at about 0T, and at 0T, of course, ECG worked just fine, and that would be the red line. And then the network was trained to try to fake ECG based on the OCM signal, that would be the green line. And when the person was brought into the scanner at 3T, then ECG got very distorted because of the magnetohydrodynamic effect, but the fake ECG from our sensors, the sensors kept working the same way as they did outside of the scanner. So we think this could be useful in terms of providing a surrogate to ECG, especially at even higher fields like 7 Tesla and beyond, where the ECG would be even more distorted, presumably beyond usefulness. Now let's look at an application where those sensors are used in a receive-only mode to spy an ultrasound scanner. The goal being to track the probe. In this application, we created another little complementary sensor, so designed and 3D printed and tabled it, and it's made to clip on the side of the ultrasound probe that we happen to be using. This here is just a piece of plastic, but it was 3D printed to have the shape of the ultrasound probe we use. And every time that the ultrasound probe sends a beam of ultrasound energy into the object, we know about it because it detects the electromagnetic activity that's associated with firing those piezoelectric crystals. Now, each time that a clinical scanner sends a beam of ultrasound energy into the object, it will listen for returning signals for about a quarter of a millisecond. And for that reason, an ultrasound image consists of about 200 different beams. That's because 200 times a quarter of a millisecond is 50 milliseconds, which corresponds to 20 frames per second. And that's roughly the frame rate that's typically being targeted in ultrasound imaging. Now, all of those beams are sent in different directions within the object, and they may involve the elements on the face of the transducer in varying degrees and in varying ways. For example, to send a beam in this direction here, what would mostly involve the elements on that side of the transducer, and to send a beam in the other direction would mostly involve an anodization function that would enhance or give privilege to the elements on the other side of the transducer. And for this reason, if you think of our little listening device here, the distance between the listening device and the most active batch on the transducer will be a function of the number. It can be shorter in some cases and longer in some cases. And that's why we get these types of results when we spy these signals. Here you can see in this beam versus delay space, the zero is defined as the instant that the beam was fired and has detected through EM activity. And then the ultrasound signal needs to travel some distance to the listening device. And the delay between the EM and the arrival of the sound signal varies with the number, as you can see here, for reasons explained on the previous slide. And the distribution of the signal in that space delay versus the number is exquisitely sensitive to the actual orientation and position of the probe in 3D. So we want to send this signal in the convolutional neural network to get as an output the position and orientation of the probe. So let's look at some results. There's a lot of information here, so we'll take a moment to go through it. The rectangular black object here represents the gel that we were using in this case. The little green disc represents the OCM sensor. This is the signal that was spied from the OCM sensor and was fed in the convolutional neural network. And the output was a prediction of where the probe was on the surface of the gel, which is shown here in green. But you can see also a yellow probe dancing on the gel, and that yellow probe is where the probe was seen to be according to optical tracking. So when our predictions make big errors, then you can see the two probes, the yellow and the green one, being really at different places, and then you can really see that two probes, a yellow one and a green one. But when our prediction is good, then the two fall pretty much on top of each other, and the result may be displayed as green and yellow, or any strange combination of the two. And because those two probes are moving around together and staying close proximity most of the time, we consider this as a promising preliminary result. So OCM sensors can be used to spy on clinical ultrasound scanners, and that can be used to track the ultrasound probe. This could be useful for compounding 3D ultrasound images into a 3D volume, or to put 3D ultrasound images in the spatial context of a pre-acquired 3D MR or CT or PET image. And we're assuming here that using this type of tracking, OCM-based tracking, would be easier and more convenient than using optical tracking, which is an important premise here. So now let's switch gears a little bit and finish with a look at our use of machine learning for translating contrast. And we'll start with magnetization pathways. Every gradient echo sequence that is not spoiled and that has gradients that are not balanced will generate replicas in this space. We can number these replicas, it will make it easier to refer to them. The zero replica is the one that shows up the closest to this space center, and it is often called a fifth. The minus first replica is typically called a sixth. Regular gradient echo sequences would focus only on the most intense replica, which is the zeroth one, and would sample only that part of K-space where that particular pathway is located. More rarely, there are sequences like this, for example, that would sample a larger region of K-space that would grab two different pathways, the zeroth and the minus first one. And even more rarely, there might be sequences that would sample three different pathways by covering a larger area of K-space, like done in the test sequence, for example. So what we did is that we developed a sequence that samples a few different pathways a couple different times at different echo times every single PR. And as you can see, these data sets really capture a lot of information about the image structure. And then we developed some equations very much based on this classic paper from Dr. Hennig to convert these data sets into quantitative maps of T1, T2, T2 star, flip angle, frequency offset, and M0. And those results were presented in that recently accepted MRI paper. But we wanted to push that one step further and use machine learning, and more specifically a neural network, to translate contrast. And that's because we've grown to believe that our multi-pathway, multi-echo acquisitions here really have a lot of information in them about the object, but that it might not be in quite the right format or the right form for radiologists to like them. So we want to feed them into a neural network that could convert them into a contrast that radiologists might be more happy with, like T1 maps, quantitative T1 maps of flare, for example. So the current version of our network was trained on 50,000 signal containing voxels, which may seem like a nice number, but all of those voxels really came from only three people. So clearly those are very preliminary results, but let's have a look at them anyway. Here we translated our multi-pathway multi-echo data in six different formats. Everyday quantitative T1 maps, T2 maps, MPRH, flare, T1 weighted, and T2 weighted. Clearly, the translation worked better in some cases than others. In each case, the image on the left is the reference, is the one that was actually acquired with a proper sequence, and the one on the right is our translated multi-pathway multi-echo result. When comparing these images, it might be good to keep in mind first that the reference images occupy the vast bulk of our imaging time. The multi-pathway multi-echo acquisition was relatively rapid compared to that, and that most of these reference images are known only in the 2D slides that is shown here, while the translated images were actually available over an entire volume that covered the entire head. So in this case, all of those different contrasts were obtained at a reasonably good spatial resolution here, and in a reasonably short scan time, which could be further reduced with more aggressive acceleration. So we think that our multi-pathway multi-echo scans do capture a great amount of information about the object, but it doesn't necessarily have the right format for radiologists to like them. But using machine learning as a contrast translator seems like a powerful approach to potentially reduce exaggeration by converting those data into any different format that might be needed. So in summary, we developed an ultrasound-based sensor, and it can be used to boost temporal resolution in MRI, or to mimic ECG signals, or to resolve breathing motion intent, or to track imaging probes in ultrasound imaging. And we hope that this sensor might prove useful enough in a large number of applications that it might become a common accessory in the future on MR scanners. And of course, we would very much like to make a wireless version of them at some point. Thank you very much.